everyone, how are you doing? This is SJS Rana, Surinderjit Singh Rana. For August 10th, 2021, time about 12:21 hours UTC. So today we're going to discuss various topics from mass surveillance to surveillance on bedrooms and bathrooms of innocent citizens, or you can call state-sponsored terrorism, or also state-sponsored surveillance agenda. We're also going to talk on various other global topics, sexual predators, population exploding, and how the catastrophe of climate crisis is making the Earth look like alien planet. Lot more things. So this some bizarre phenomena occurring all across the globe, and how things get interconnected, folks. You got to start connecting the dots. What's going on? You got to see the unseen. Start connecting the dots, you will come to know. So I have this small session to present some connection of dots, but I'm still leaving some dots unconnected so you can understand. First, let's look at the sun. So sun is giving some bizarre looks, and we see new sunspots which are going to have massive flares on Earth is going to appear. So I think a week more. So August 10th, I think by August 17th, we should start getting flares on planet Earth. So it will start burning planet Earth. That's what I'm predicting. Because folks, there are so many things going on. You are not seeing, you are not knowing. That doesn't mean things are not there. If massive surveillance or surveillance by state or by agencies on the bedrooms of people can approach, or bathrooms of people, innocents, then where is law and order? Where is moral justice? Where is ethical justice? Where is global human rights? All these topics are prime important. So first come first, let's discuss what's going on with India, the largest democratic nation known to the planet Earth and people, the most populous democratic nation with 1.4 billion people and ruled by government of democracy. Let's see what's going on in India. How India is upset recently, discovery of this Pegasus software, and it says it's the law of surveillance and national security. Because recently this software was seen infringing rights on many mobile or cell phone users, where they had some backdoor option and they got backdoor entry to this phones, and phones of prime, or you can say, you know, top elite were being surveillanced. Now, since many officials, top officials, you can say top cops or top judiciary or top lawyers or top politicians were surveillanced, so this topic became a huge hue and cry. If it would have been average civilians, they don't care. They don't care. But because people are targeted who are top connected officials, it's an act of terrorism. I tell you, the definition of terrorism has become a laughable situation, a joke. Government is defining terrorism only when government people are attacked or their institutions are attacked. But if the civilians' rights are attacked or civilians are attacked, gang rapes are happening, government laughs. They say that's a normal routine. That's not terrorism. If the government changes law to have financial terrorism on people, they don't call it terrorism. They call it law. If you don't abide by it, you're not law-abiding citizens. But if you abide by whatever laws they present, then you're law-abiding. Just like recently, India government was basically dragged to the France International Tribunal Court by Cairn Energy. And what a sham India government was, that it never admitted ever since 2014 that they were committing financial terrorism on Cairn Energy and many international companies who are getting into India. But now they got caught red-handed. So they say, yes, we agree, this was financial terrorism. So you have to drag these people to the courts, only then they admit. Otherwise they say, we are just spotless. These are our laws of the land. So let's discuss and review some laws of the land. Recently, this Pegasus software has put the whole surveillance agenda on top of the mind of top judiciary of India. And even the Supreme Court of India is reviewing this petition. On August 10th, they had this petition, which is called public interest litigation, what we call lawsuits or civil lawsuits in US and many other nations. But it's called this. Now, what's going on? Under this act, they are reviewing Section 5 of 2, which is the right of privacy. See, surveillance has got two branches. One is surveillance, which is massive surveillance done on public places. Let's say on a park, on a stadium, Olympic ground, public toilets, public parks, public places, even to the public officials, you know, let's say cops, let's say top branch of government. Well, that's our public place. Courts, they're public place. So surveillance is understood. But what happens when these surveillance is infringing upon the privacy of average citizens or innocents? Well, under India section of privacy and laws, section 5.2 states the right to privacy of the context of surveillance officers argued in 1996, People Union of Civil Liberties versus Union of India. And under this constitution, under this act, the Supreme Court declined to strike down the provisions as unconstitutional of surveillance. But it did say something. It say that the principle of surveillance must meet two criteria. One is the legitimacy of the public body, going through the fact that either that contingent or that individual is a threat to public, or it's some terrorist activity. These two things have to be declared. Either it's a threat to public safety, or it's like some terrorist activity. Unless these two things are declared, no agency under the authority of India, government or judiciary or executive branch, can just do blind surveillance on privacy of people, folks. Because if privacy is another global human right, nobody can, have a surveillance. No government authority or no military authority anywhere in the world under democratic institution can have a surveillance over your bedrooms, over your bathrooms. Unless those two provisions as categorized by the Supreme Court or the Constitution of India. Because there is Article 21 and 22 of India Constitution, which stands firm on right to liberty, freedom of every individual. If those constitutions are violated by authorities, by agencies, by, you can say, some stooges, some crooks, or some criminal carters or criminal cronies working for government, then these are infringement of Article 21 and 22, and any negligence of duty on government servant, public servant, will be prosecuted under the law. And that's what India Constitution is now trying to set up. And these are various topics that have come forward. Even the political arena has got activated now. All the political arenas of India, you call it BJP, Congress. These are two main parties, just like you have Dems, Democrats and Republicans in US. So they are also after this privacy, infringement of privacy or infringement of surveillance of individual. They are going forward for it. And recently some very glaring petition or glaring public interest litigation has been filed in Supreme Court of India. Today PIL was being heard on August 10th and it was deferred to the next date. Because they still didn't get all the parties together and all the required documents and experts. So I think they are going to make some big decision on the privacy, on the individual rights, human rights, and how much surveillance is possible in the bedrooms or bathrooms of the innocents or civilians. How much is that constitutional? And how much is that just? Are they all going to become like a criminal crony? Are they all going to become state-sponsored terrorism, which can snoop into your bathroom and bedrooms and your private movements? Are they going to become state-sponsored terrorism under democracy, Constitution of India, Article 21 and 22? That's the question which 1.4 billion population of India is asking India government and judiciary. And they are trying to address this part now. And they are saying this petition was put forward, but this has been deferred. A move from August 10 to accept notice also questioned why the matter was suddenly put up in such a hasty manner. And also we are seeing how Western nations, especially all democratic nations, make a complete, a nexus to hone on communist nation, especially like China. They target that, making broad headlines that the perfect police state paints a picture of the surveillance China uses to monitor, ethnic minorities or something. Well, before doing any dirty laundry on communist nation, I think the democratic nation ought to address this surveillance agenda or state-sponsored terrorism, including those the largest democratic nation known as India, which they call the darling of US. Yes, India is called darling of US. United States. Why it's called darling of the US? Because it is going by every agenda they think it's possible on sun. Whether it's state-sponsored terrorism, whether it's financial terrorism, all is fine. But anything China does, oh, it's a communist atom bomb. It's a communist nuclear warhead. So folks, this double standard should go away. I think the planet Earth needs one common agenda, which is called the ethical human being. The law should be same for every nation, whether it's communist, democratic, whether it's falling none of those, atheist or east falling, you know, God or not falling God, doesn't matter. The law should be common for all, and all the nations should strive for ethical human being and ethical standards. Global human rights should be placed forward. So what's going on here, you can see, you know, 24/7, if you are living under the situation, what that means, that your entire life is surveillance 24/7 by the state, non-stop by cameras, by artificial intelligence, by a predictive policy system that predicts whether or not you are going to commit a crime in future, like a thought criminal. What else is this Orwellian future, Orwellian George Orwellian 1984, being implemented all across, also known as state-sponsored terrorism? Yes, folks, this is a very serious question. If you are living under constant situation of surveillance, your surveillance 24/7 by state, non-stop by cameras, by artificial intelligence, yes, folks, now artificial intelligence is being deployed across every fabric of life, of human values. These state-sponsored terrorism are using the artificial intelligence, computers, quantum mechanics, to have predictive analysis about personal behavior. And based on these what you call idiots, nincompoops, are playing metaphor games. Especially in India, we see a lot of people befooling other people playing these metaphor games, where they are using this high-end artificial intelligence algorithms and machines behind supercomputers, who are having the data for a 1 year or 2 year of massive surveillance, not only on public places but also private places, which is called covert surveillance by military grade ops. So what is this going on? They think people are fool. They think they are God. Yes, they are manifesting themselves as God now, because with this machine of artificial intelligence, Schrodinger equations, they can have predictive analysis. They can know what the other person will mean, or where it will be, or what it's going to happen, because the artificial intelligence is doing all these permutations and combinations. And with these, it can do predictive analysis. But this should be used for catching criminals, not for making metaphor games on innocents and trying to entrap and slay females. Stalk them when the time, you would know from these AI machines that when the female will be free, what's going with the particular female or minor girl, and when to attack that girl sexually. I mean, if that is going to be used for such purpose, then, you know, hell breaks loose on Earth. You'll find fires, you'll find, you know, burning Earth, because you think it's an ethical human being? Well, that's the introspection. So political parties must publish criminal antecedents of candidates within 48 hours of this selection. This is the Supreme Court verdict now, because India, political parties are infested with criminals or criminal intent people. Already almost 48-49% of all political parties candidates, or you know, who are in the political parties or having won the elections, are facing some or the other criminal case in the court of India. That's the real estimate. But Supreme Court has taken the action in public interest of the citizens of India, trying to, you know, basically iron out or trying to dirty laundry these people, that, you know, they got to be giving all their credentials, what many criminal cases they are having, why they're having, whether it's like aggravated sexual assault or, you know, entrapment, enslavement, stalking females. Yes, these candidates are having such rape cases, but they are elected by people. People say, no, that's okay. That's good for the state. So now they have come heavy on these people, Supreme Court of India, trying to dirty laundry all these people out and bring some fresh, good people, ethical human beings, so there can be some justice restored for India and for the largest democracy of the world. So these new rulings have come, where they have the ECI, which is the Election Commission of India, has been directed to create a dedicated mobile application containing information published by candidates regarding their criminal antecedents, so that no one can stroke. Each voter gets such information on his or her mobile phone. So the mobile phone is a must for everyone. When they go to voters, or going for a vote, they must carry their mobile phone, so they have the information on hand. See, last in 2000, last elections, February, I didn't vote because they didn't allow officially over here in phase 3B to Mohali, SAS Nagar Mohali over here. I never get to vote. They denied my right to carry a phone there. They say, no, you cannot vote if you have a cell phone with you. I say, what do you mean by that? I'm not using cell phone to vote. It's just being my personal assistant. It's just with me. But they didn't allow. They say, no, turn back. Unless you submit your phone to us, we won't allow you inside the voters bank. I said, forget. I'm not going to even vote. You choose your voting then. I didn't participate, folks. Because, you know, it takes nothing to join the crowd. But it takes everything to stand alone. So I stood alone. And I keep standing alone till this date. And the crowd's enjoying here in India. They're clapping on pedophiles. That the sexual predators population is exploding in India. They don't know what to do. They don't know what to do. Because there is no contingent on them. No party, political party has any mandate. What they're going to do with increased criminal activities, human trafficking empire roaming on streets. This is what happens when you choose the wrong people. Then it's given to human trafficking empire. The whole contract is given to them. They run on streets, they race on streets, honking here and there, alerting pedophiles of when the delivery of girls will take place, what is going around in the situation, what is the outcome of metaphor games. Yes, I see it all around. Every CCTV of 3B2 Mohali here, especially, you know, where I'm residing, they know these pedophiles, these human trafficking empire agents are spread across, racing on streets. Because pedophiles like it. Sexual predator population here like it. They're getting free delivery of girls, females. Why would they comment? Why would they even object on this? So folks, you got to look at the world. It's burning. The sexual predator population are exploding. India especially thriving with it. Human trafficking empire agents are luring governments that they can increase the GDP by 2 or 3%. So folks, let's look at this. This is some topic which has come in India now. India constitution or India lawmakers allow, which is called a marital rape. They openly allow for a husband to rape wife or the girl. That's allowed in India law and India constitution per the lawmakers of India. But now there is a revolt going on. Many females who are daily surviving sexual assault from their husband inside their home. They say it's a terror horror home where they're being sexually assaulted, enslaved day and night and threatened. They are saying we are revolting now, we can't take it anymore. Because what we are producing in the end. You look at Olympics, what was India producing? A javelin throw gold. It was like a fluke. Well, people, that's what people are saying, it's like a fluke. It's not a real gold. Real gold is when you get through some real concentration. Like you're running, you're marathoning, or you're swimming, or you're like shooting targets. Where people are giving the shooting targets and they target with the arrow. On the right bullseye. That's what is called the real gold Olympic. So that's what female are complaining. What are they producing eventually? If they are going to get raped at home. By the sexual predator population. So folks, this is a serious affair. And now the laws are changing. Kerala High Court. High Court of India, you can say. Kerala High Court. Has recently started doing this thing. That they are started accommodating the rape victims of in marriage called marital rape, and they're giving them the divorce. It's a high court. It's not a local session court or a district court. It's a high court. So high court means a lot. It has a lot of standing. Hopefully this is a new trend, a paradigm shift. Perhaps they are going to count marital rapes as a living proof of female's life and liberty in India under Constitution Article 21 and 22. So they have cited these articles, Section 13 of Hindu Marriage Act and Section 27 of the Special Marriage Act. Court held the fact that the law does not recognize marital rape as a criminal offense, does not prevent the court from recognizing it. However, it will come under the cruelty. So they say we are giving this liberty to females now, or married females who are being raped by their husband in India can go and approach under these sections and claim as a marital rape and grounds for divorce. So this is some big change going on. And you know, the situation of rape and gang rapes and threat to these females are so high that even recently the court of Delhi said, go out only when necessary. Inform security. This is to the female, a rape gang rape survivor. Can you imagine the court has to order a female, go out only when necessary and inform the security. It's like inform everyone that you're going out. You never know which sexual predator or the association of sexual predators here in India are going to attack you from what angle. So this is the threat, the terrorism the females are living under. And India calls terrorism is only when a grenade is launched or a missile is launched. When you hear India on UNSC forums or any international forum, they say, oh, when a missile is launched, that's called terrorism. But when a female is gang raped, it's not terrorism. They say it's a normal thing. When a female is raped in home, marital rape, they say it's okay. It's not a marital rape, it's not a rape. It's a regular course of action. What? They're making fool of people? Well, it's a long topic, but you know, some change is coming here. The Delhi court on Monday directed the, you know, rape survivor who has been provided security by the Central Reserve Police Force to step out only when necessary until the case is over and inform her personal security officers before going out. So her, it's like the rapist is on loose, but the survivor is in a cage. Well, folks, there's a lot of bizarre things going on this planet. Let's hear this next story. It's unbelievable. Outrageous. The court reduces jail time for a rapist, says the rape lasted only 11 minutes. What? What are you seeing here? What are you hearing? It's totally unbelievable. I have to read it again. Let's take a break. You need time to digest this. It says it reduces jail time for a rapist because rape lasted only 11 minutes. So what this Switzerland court is saying, we are going to announce the rape, pronounce the rape sentence based on minutes you spend on raping females? I mean, I don't know what's going on with this earth. Is it like a mental stress effect on judiciary, on people like advocates out of COVID-19 disaster? What is this going on earth? Look over here, news, 81 years old, retired professor, friend held for gang raping, domestic help in Bhopal, in India. 81 years old? Still have the audacity and stamina, like Olympics, to rape, gang rape females? I can't believe it, folks. I don't know whether this news is real or this world is unreal. I mean, I'm living in twilight zone now. Hearing these news, I even can digest what these people are saying. I sometimes feel it's like a COVID-19 disaster after effects. World may be saying they are covering on finances from the global impact of COVID-19, but I think the mental stress and the degradation, perversion has gone beyond limits.
First of all, talk us through these accusations more specifically. What are they?
Well, they're very serious accusations, and indeed the pressure is increasing. It's gone from rumbling on to this new dramatic development in America, and the fact that this US woman now publicly alleges she was brought to the UK age 17 to have sex with Prince Andrew, one of the sons of Her Majesty the Queen. She has overnight filed a case in New York claiming publicly and very officially now that he abused her here in London when she was 17, then abused her in New York, and then later on also at an orgy in another home of Mr. Epstein. Prince Andrew is 61. He has categorically, repeatedly denied Ms. Giuffre's claims. But of course, this has now taken on a much more official turn. And I think it's fair to characterize the US version of this young, well, no longer young woman, but at the time of these alleged facts and this alleged sexual acts without her consent as extremely serious. But that the allegation is that Prince Andrew has obfuscated, that he has said that he was willing to cooperate, but really hasn't, from their side of things, not done so.
Benedict, as we were saying, this does definitely step up public pressure on the prince. Has there been any reaction from the palace so far?
Well, these came overnight.
Looking at the sexual predators population of India and pedophiles exploding in India, the High Court of India, Kerala High Court, has come up with the redefining of rape clause for minor girls, also known as under POSCO Act, and the 375 section of IPC, Indian Penal Code, has been redefined now by the Kerala High Court to assist minor girls. Imagine a 10 years, 9 years old girl who has no knowledge of what the pedophile or sexual predator is going to attack, how she will know. She's just like 9 years old, because massive number of minor girls are being attacked in India daily by the sexual pedophiles. So the High Court has redefined, and it's saying, you know, section 375 takes in sexual assaults beyond penile penetration into private parts of females and girls, including mouth or faces and, you know, other body parts. They're also saying these sexual predators are using, you know, something very grave, something very pervert, depraved sexual acts on minor girls. Talking of sexual assaults and predators population exploding in India, another reason is the parents are getting involved in outsourcing their daughter to get raped or gang raped. You can call a human trafficking empire association. Parents, folks, parents are getting involved, selling their minor daughters, minor girls to pedophiles, top pedophiles of the town, or you can say a wealthy pedophile having one or two cars. These parents will sell their minor daughters to have them raped in front of their eyes, with a top sexual predator of the town who will have one or two cars or three cars, and he'll show, see, I have this much of money to pay you for one night. And they will sell their daughters. What insanity is going on earth? Police produced the parents before the judicial first class magistrate court, where they were remanded in custody. The incident took place when a local resident caught one of the accused while he was allegedly trying to sexually abuse a victim in an empty house. June 25. According to the girl, the accused had taken her to various places.
Chinese e-commerce giant Alibaba today announced that a male employee accused of sexually assaulting a female colleague has been fired, and that two executives who mishandled the assault report have resigned. The statement followed the woman's account going viral on social media platforms. Police in Jinan City, Shandong Province, say that they're investigating and gathering evidence on the alleged rape case. Alibaba's Hong Kong listed share price dropped today on the news and closed down by 2.5%. Oh, no.
one of the region's best parks, now one of the most dangerous.
Just really devastated because I just thought I was safe.
Residents reeling, a predator on the run after attacking a jogger at Aurora Boulevard Park in North Lakes on Saturday evening.
She's been dragged from the footpath into the toilet block where she was sexually assaulted. She was knocked unconscious as a result of this.
The offender fled on foot. He's described as Caucasian, around 170 centimetres tall with a thin build. He has short blonde hair, is clean shaven and has an American Eagle tattoo on his left tricep. Resident Steve Foster says he noticed a man fitting that description last week.
I said to my wife, there's a fella that's been sitting on the end of that seat on that walkway and he's making out he's reading a book, just a young fella. And I said, I reckon he's up to no good.
And he's returned since the attack.
On Monday, I'm certain he was back here because it was him that I seen sitting on that seat.
Of most concern to residents, just how brazen the attack was, less than 10 metres from where children play.
For me, with four kids, to think that at a family park, that something like this could happen is devastating.
Police are asking for help from the public to catch this dangerous predator, fearing he could strike again. Samantha Heathwood, 7 News.
Tracking some breaking news. Arizona Senator Tony Navarrete of West Phoenix has been arrested, accused of sexual misconduct with a minor.
The incident happened in 2019, but investigators say the survivor just came forward. Navarrete is currently in custody awaiting charges.
You'll get the latest details tomorrow morning on Today in AZ starting at 4:30 in the morning.
It's going crazy, folks, here. I mean, sexual predators population at workplace are thriving on predating females. So recently, Melissa DeRosa resigned Sunday night on the reports that Cuomo, which was the governor of New York, was sexually harassing, molesting females. 7 females have come forward, and the top cops, the Assembly of New York has said they have credible evidence against governor. High position of governor, sexually enslaving and trapping, and you say molesting, harassing females at work. Females at work, folks. I mean, they're coming here to work because they want their paycheck to feed their families. Imagine the plight of these females. So 11 females have come forward. I mean, these brave females, because it takes audacity and it takes courage to launch an investigation on governor of the state, New York. Folks, I've lived in New York. I've lived in America, U.S., for almost 7 years. I've worked there. I know the state of New York because I used to live in New Jersey, Lodi. And I used to work in Whippany. I used to work in Mahwah, with very big top companies. And I also used to work in, contract basis in New York. And New York is a very, very beautiful place. That way people are very multicultural, orientation. Very nice place. But you see, governor of New York, I can't believe. I'm now residing here years. Because I moved in 2010 back to India from Canada. Earlier, I was working in New Jersey. I was residing there. And I know people are very, very open-minded and very just people. But I can't believe this is going on in US also. I mean, I thought India was infested with or infected by a virus of pedophiles and sexual predator population. But I could never recollect or reckon the US infected with such high number of people at high places. Reading the news there, it came made headlines. Okay, another news making headlines is the contractor to allow video surveillance of employees at home and bedrooms. So what is this going on in US? US is another democratic nation, and if the contractor are allowed to have video surveillance on employees' homes and bedrooms, this is unbelievable, folks. This is the surveillance on privacy, infringing upon the personal private rights. If you are having surveillance on bedrooms and bathrooms of people, washrooms of people, then the planet will have nothing else to burn. It will burn by itself, folks. As I keep predicting things, folks, from sjsrana, you can Google search sjsrana. What I'm seeing from sun and the mother nature giving me heeds is we have very serious times coming ahead of us.
Guinea has reported West Africa's first confirmed death from the Marburg virus. Marburg is in the same virus family as Ebola and causes hemorrhagic fever. Outbreaks in the past have mostly occurred in East Africa.
So this Marburg virus has reappeared in Guinea. And this Marburg virus has been detected in West Africa after man dies in some province there. So this was the case of this Marburg virus. It was detected in Democratic Republic of Congo, Kenya, but it was never seen in West Africa. Now it's trying to come up in West Africa. It's very, very threatening situation. And it's the modification or mutation of Ebola virus. It has very high fatality rate, above 88%, folks, unlike COVID-19. COVID-19 is, you can say, a kid in compared to Marburg virus or the virus, with 88% fatality, mortality rate, folks. So this is alarming situation. And I keep telling, reminding the humanity, planet Earth, that by December, November 2021, we're going to see virus go airborne. Folks, virus are going to go airborne. Why? Because sexual predators population are helping these viruses, assisting these viruses. Scenario of Earth, Mother Nature is having her wrath on planet Earth. It's all in red, it's code red. Folks, there are many reasons I can't explain. It's beyond comprehension. It's beyond
around
this small topic.
We got an alert from the official Greece government, which said to leave and evacuate from Pevki and from any other areas which might be close to the fires. It's like a scene of an apocalyptic movie, definitely, because there is no sky, the sun is red, has been red the entire day, so it's quite scary, and it's uneasy. It's making people uneasy, that's for sure.
It's time to leave. The fires are getting closer and closer to this village. Just a few miles from here, there are bright blue skies, but here the air is full of smoke and ash, and it's making it harder for people to breathe.
You know, in my condition, pregnant woman with small child, okay, I didn't feel safe at home, like in the horror movie. But now, this is not the movie, this is our real life, this is horror that we live for the last 1 week, almost 1 week. And you doesn't know if this horror will stop tonight, or tomorrow, or in 5 days.
Nations expert climate panel has found the planet is warming rapidly and that Australia faces longer, hotter summers with more droughts and bushfires. It comes in the lead up to November's climate summit in Glasgow and lifts pressure on the Morrison government to increase its carbon cutting ambitions.
A burning pram. Dire United Nations report on
goddamn brief.
It says burning coal, oil and gas has warmed the planet by 1.1 degrees since the 19th century, and that will rise to 1.5 degrees within 2 decades, a faster pace than expected. Beyond that tipping point, the dangers of extreme weather grow considerably. To prevent that, all nations must agree to stop pumping carbon dioxide into the atmosphere by 2050 at the latest. The Prime Minister is under fire for not setting more ambitious climate targets as the world prepares to set new goals in Glasgow in November.
The intensity, frequency and duration of fire weather events are projected to increase throughout Australia. Will the Prime Minister ignore this warning too?
Why won't you show the leadership that we need and commit to net zero emissions by 2050?
We should achieve net zero as soon as possible, Mr. Speaker, and preferably by 2050.
This planet doesn't look like it's planet Earth. It looks like alien planet. It looks like as if we are living in Mars. Look at this red planet now. It's planet Earth, yeah, blue planet Earth. I could never understand how planet, blue planet Earth turned to this red. It's Martian planet, folks. We got to change. I mean, we got to shift planets now.
Officials on Sunday said the raging Dixie Fire in Northern California is now the second largest recorded in the state's history, days after the blaze destroyed a historic gold rush town and forced the evacuation of thousands. State fire officials said the massive wildfire had grown to almost 500,000 acres as of Sunday morning and was 21% contained. Only last year's August complex fire, which consumed more than 1 million acres, was bigger. So far, no deaths have been attributed to the wildfire, but at least 8 people were missing as of late Saturday. 5 of the missing belonged to the old mining town of Greenville, where the fire leveled most of its downtown about 160 miles north of Sacramento. The cause of the fire remains under investigation. Pacific Gas and Electric has said it may have started.
Okay, folks, with this, I wrap the session. Climate catastrophe is coming. We got to be prepared. And what's humanity doing? Population explosion, urbanization. All these topics you can search on Google. You can search on YouTube under SJS Rana, Surinderjit Singh Rana. And you'll get these searches, these images, these contents. And my address is listed here on Google. So everything is upfront on you. You can contact. But Indian agencies, authorities, having massive surveillance on innocents, on human rights activists, don't allow simple calls from international pass-through. They are intercepting my calls. They're intercepting everything. Even they don't allow directly to approach me on my home location. There are many agencies, crocodiles. On the way, they try to attack people who try to approach human rights. That's the pathetic part of India, largest democracy of the world. But now it's getting unearthed. Okay, folks, I'll take the leave if you want to reach me on my number, local number of India. If agencies over here don't intercept and allow the call to pass through, because many times when you call, the phone keep buzzing, and it's buzzing on desk of some agency. I never get the call. I tell you, I don't talk to people a lot. I don't receive a call. Unless I call someone over here, which I know in past. There are very few people I call. My daily log of phone is just like, you can say 10 minutes or 20 minutes of call to my known people. And that to 1 or 2 limited people. No call comes through to me directly. I tell you, folks, this is state-sponsored terrorism. This is what the agencies are doing at the background, trying to hunt down on human rights activists. They're hunting them down.